made everything.
The God of the Bible, triune, self-existent, sovereign, without rival.
Triune?
Yes, one nature in three persons. Father, Son, and Spirit, same essence, unique working.
How do you know this?
From the only true evidence, the 66 books of the Old and New Testament.
If the Jews of the first century didn't already believe that God existed in a triune form, isn't the Trinitarian view in conflict with Jewish thought? Dr. Brown, our Jewish member of the panel, let's start with you.
You know, look, the fundamental thing that everyone here at this table agrees with is that the Messiah had to die and rise from the dead, and that was the one thing that the disciples missed, that they didn't understand, and that there's almost no evidence or no evidence that Jews at that time were expecting a suffering Messiah, certainly not a crucified Messiah, and yet that's the one thing that happened. So there's no question that there were blind spots. And if we can agree that there was a blind spot on the most fundamental of all things, then the death of the Messiah, his disciples couldn't get it. After he rose from the dead, Luke 24, he had to open their minds to understand the scriptures. Mm-hmm. When in Matthew 16, Jesus says that he's going to go to the cross, Peter rebukes him. You're never going to go to the cross. So the fact that they may not have fully understood the complexity of God's nature, that doesn't surprise me at all. But what's interesting, though, is that you do have some things developing. Philo is an older contemporary of Jesus, and he talks about the Logos a lot, the very word John uses for word in John 1:1. And he even speaks of the Logos as a creative agent, even as a second God. It's very, very interesting. And the Targums, which are the Jewish paraphrases, they go back in some form even before the time of Jesus and then develop. They begin to talk about the Memra of the Lord, the word of the Lord, and this Memra even takes on a distinct identity. So what they're struggling with is how to identify, how to fully understand this God who is imminent and yet transcendent, who is visible and yet invisible. So Yeshua brings it to light, John 1:18, he makes him known, as James quoted earlier, he exegetes the Father. So number one, there were fundamental things that the Jewish people of that day were getting wrong. Jesus explicitly addresses it on numerous occasions. And number two, there are streams of thought already developing in Jewish tradition and in Jewish philosophy that fit very well in with the concept of God's triunity. Benjamin Summer, professor at Jewish Theological Seminary, says the plain reading of Genesis 18 is quite clear about Yahweh appearing in bodily form, and that any Jew faithful to Scripture and Jewish tradition should have no problem with the Trinity. You should also check the Talmudic discussion of Genesis 18 because it points in this very direction of an identification, physical identification of Yahweh with the one who is there. But I'm beholden to the scriptural text, which is quite clear, but I wanted to correct the misrepresentation that you just gave.
In the time frame from Adam to the first century, did the Jewish people view God as existing in a triune form? God the Father, Son, Messiah, and Holy Spirit. 2 minutes.
We don't have a lot of Jewish literature that's extant, that gets into theological discussion. Certainly it affirms the oneness of God. I affirm that. You may challenge that, but I'm affirming the same thing Yeshua affirmed and the same thing Paul affirmed and the same thing Isaiah affirmed. Most of the discussion has to do with either legal issues, which you'll find in Dead Sea Scrolls, some discussion there, or other eschatological issues. But there certainly, as far back as we can go in Jewish tradition, as it begins to evolve after the time of Jesus, we find things like the Shekhinah, the manifest presence of God on the earth. We find a developing theory of the Sefirot, which are the emanations of God, because there's the constant question, how can the infinite, eternal, invisible God be manifest and touchable on the earth? So we have the answer through the gospel, the wonderful good news that the Son came into the world and revealed God to us as the sent one, of course. But other Jewish literature then begins to react against this in the centuries that follow. But I would agree with Professor Benjamin Summer that any Jew who's true to the scriptures and Jewish tradition should have no problem with God's triunity.
I have a question in Jewish writings. Do we have the wisdom? Do we have knowledge? Are these ever personified? And are they perceived as a deity?
Actually, the rabbinic writings, Talmud, Midrash, have quite a few statements where the Holy Spirit is clearly personified in such a way that's even stronger than New Testament witness and the Holy Spirit interceding with God on behalf of individuals. So the rabbinic writings actually point in this direction without them rightly even embracing what their own writings are saying. Not only so, I'm not saying that the Spirit of God is a separate person from God. You are. I'm saying it is one God, Father, Son, and Spirit. What's also fascinating is when you draw attention to the Holy Spirit never worshipped, and we give you clear passages where Jesus is worshipped the same way with the same words that are given to the Father, you blow that off. So I mean, you have to have it one way or the other. Either accept that Jesus is worshipped as Lord and God in the New Testament, or not.
The high theological level to just straightforward, how can God have flesh and bones? Isn't that what Trinitarians teach?
No, we're saying that God appears in human form. Colossians 2:9, the fullness of God dwells in bodily form.
So
Genesis 18, Yahweh appears in bodily form. And that's not a unique concept in the ancient Near East, by the way, for a God or the God to appear in bodily form. The Bible says that happened with Yahweh. Genesis 3 would point in the same direction, that Yahweh is actually walking with Adam and Eve in the cool of the garden. So God can manifest himself in 1,000 different ways. And he manifested himself in flesh and blood form while remaining God enthroned in heaven, while filling the universe by his Spirit. So we are not saying that God ceased to be God and came down off the throne and became a human being like Zeus or one of these other so-called gods.
Exactly.
We are saying that he comes and dwells. It says in 1:14, John 1:14, he pitched his tent among us. It's the exact equivalent of the tabernacle. Scholars have pointed out that he is like an earthly walking tabernacle.
Well, the interesting thing tonight is that I'm the only Jew on the panel here. And with all my heart and soul, I hold to the Shema. I hold to the oneness of God, that there is only one God, and I would die for that principle. I'm captive by the Scripture. When the overwhelming witness of the New Testament is that the Son is eternally preexistent, I have to bow down to the truth of the Word and recognize that the one God that I worship is complex in his unity. He is hidden and yet is revealed. He sits enthroned in heaven and yet fills the universe and can visit us on this earth even in bodily form. The Scriptures are explicit that John says that Isaiah saw Jesus, saw the Son. The Scriptures are explicit in multiple testimony, verse after verse, that it was through the Son that the universe was made. And recover who Jesus truly is according to the Scriptures. Based on that, when we look at the person and work of the Spirit and put it all together, we get one God, only one God, complex in his unity, to which Jesus is the number one witness.
Thank you.
If you repented of your sins, testify. If you trusted in Jesus, testify. If you believe in his death, burial, and resurrection, testify. Say what? Testify. If you're saved by grace, then testify. If you're seeking God's face, then testify. If you know that you were put here to glorify God, then testify. Say what? Testify. Yeah.